From Washington, D.C., this is Middle East Focus.
Hello, and welcome to Middle East Focus, a weekly podcast on regional affairs and U.S. policy produced by the Middle East Institute in Washington, D.C. I'm Alistair Taylor, MEI's editorial director. On today's program, we'll be discussing the United Arab Emirates as the country celebrates its 50th anniversary on December 2nd. We'll be touching on how the UAE got here and the challenges it faces going forward, as well as the country's economic development, diversification efforts, foreign policy issues, and regional and global objectives. Gerald Feierstein, MEI Senior Vice President and a Distinguished Senior Fellow on U.S. Diplomacy, will be moderating the discussion today and will be joined by Afshin Malavi and Courtney Freer. Afshin is a senior fellow at the Foreign Policy Institute at the Johns Hopkins University School of Advanced International Studies and founder of the Emerging World Newsletter on Substack. He's a former Dubai, Jeddah, Riyadh, and Tehran-based journalist working for Reuters, Arab News, and the Washington Post, and has served as an advisor to Oxford Analytica, as well as the International Finance Corporation. His essays and writings have appeared in the Financial Times, Bloomberg, National Geographic, and other publications, and he serves on the advisory board of the Economics and Energy Program at MEI. Courtney is Provost's postdoctoral fellow at Emory College in Atlanta. She previously served as the Assistant Professorial Research Fellow at the Middle East Center at the London School of Economics and Political Science from 2015 until 2021. She's also a non-resident fellow in the Foreign Policy Program at the Brookings Institution.
Welcome to Afshin and Courtney today. Delighted to have this opportunity to talk about UAE at 50 years. And of course, the December 2nd was in fact the 50th anniversary, the official anniversary of the UAE creation. And I wanted to turn to you, Courtney, first to talk a little bit about how the UAE came into existence. After all, this was seven separate emirates up until 1972. Today, it is a unified country. And in many ways, this has been a remarkable development, hasn't it? Because these were seven distinct personalities, seven distinct cultures, traditions, and yet they've come together in a remarkable way.
Yes, absolutely. And thanks for having me. I think the Emirates is really a fascinating example, especially when it comes to the Gulf, because you do have still these very seven distinct entities, six different ruling families. And yet there is at the same time a pretty strong kind of national brand, I would say. And I think there was a lot of hesitation and a lot of concern about the extent to which these seven independent entities would be able to and willing to kind of work together as one unit, as you can imagine, because it is difficult to kind of find a system through which they're all heard. And I think the federal system has managed to integrate them. I think it was only in 1996 that Ras Al Khaimah ended up integrating into the military. So there, you know, it didn't happen overnight, but I think now there is this strong sense of, as I mentioned, Emirati nationalism. I think a lot of that links back to the role that Sheikh Zayed played as kind of a father of the nation. And I do think what's also interesting when you visit the Emirates is that each emirate still does feel distinct. Ras Al Khaimah is very different from Dubai, and there are still efforts to maintain that uniqueness. So you have some classes in Al-Shahi dialect, which is from the Northern Emirates, and that's still being taught and kind of being revived in these heritage courses. So I think that there is still some preservation of what is unique about these distinct emirates, which I think makes the federation probably stronger ultimately.
And of course, one of the things, and you touched on it a little bit, is that in terms of economic resources, size, population, there are rather large differences between the Southern Emirates and the Northern Emirates, and yet somehow they have managed to pull it all together. In recent years, of course, particularly under Mohammed bin Zayed and his leadership, they have really made an effort to establish a sense of Emirati nationhood versus the more traditional pan-Arab or pan-Islamic kind of identity that you've seen in the region. And how is that working out?
I think this kind of brand of nationalism is stronger than we've seen in the past. I think that I've seen some survey data showing, you know, that a lot of Emirati young people are kind of proud to be Emirati. And I think this is a broader trend throughout the Gulf, where we see stronger state-led nationalism taking over as these states, you know, become more mature and as they've been more successful in terms of carving out spaces for themselves, in terms of how they operate in the domestic sphere and how they operate internationally. And I think the Emirates have, you know, established for itself a pretty strong brand. I mean, in the early 2000s, we talked a lot about the Dubai model and this idea of, you know, having a space in the Gulf which is not reliant on hydrocarbons and is diversified and is a place that people from around the world go to. And that's something that, you know, that was the first city in the Gulf that really managed to do that and has led to other cities kind of making that move towards diversification as well. And then, you know, after that, I say in more recent years, we've seen more activist foreign policy by the Emiratis, which again kind of carves out a space for themselves within the region and within the world, really, that, you know, shows who they are as a nation. And I think that that's felt on the ground in terms of people feeling a connection to the country as the state, rather than just a connection to, say, something like tribe or local emirate.
Afshin, we've heard a little bit from Courtney about the political aspects. What happened 50 years ago that allowed these seven separate emirates to come together and really form a united state in the region? The same question, of course, applied to how they went about building their economy, because again, these are seven emirates with very different states of development, different economic resources, different traditions. And how have they gone about, at the same time, building a unified and integrated economy? And how's that working?
Well, I think it's a very good question, Jerry, because I think one of the things that you've probably experienced when you've traveled to the UAE, and I'm sure Courtney has experienced as well, is when you visit a government office or even private sector offices, whether it's in Dubai or Abu Dhabi or Sharjah or Ajman or one of the Emirates, you often will see these pictures on the wall. And I call them the before and after shots, right? And the before are not 100 years ago or 150 or 200 years ago. They're sometimes in the 1980s. And the iconic before image that you often see is the Sheikh Zayed Road in Dubai, which is the main thoroughfare in Dubai. And the pictures from the 1980s, even until the mid to late 1980s, were a few low-lying buildings, a couple of tall buildings, and lots of dust and sand. And then you walk down the hall a bit and you see the after pictures. And the after pictures are this gleaming Manhattan-style skyline and skyscrapers that are touching the clouds and bustling traffic. And you see the similar before and after pictures and with Abu Dhabi, the Corniche, and you see it in Ajman and Sharjah and Ras Al Khaimah as well. Now, one of the before and after pictures, and this is a way to answer your question, that you don't see is the human development. That's not as easily captured in a before and after shot. But when you look at the indicators in the UAE from 1971 to today, you know, all of the charts are moving up and to the right in terms of, you know, education levels, access to secondary education, tertiary education, female labor force participation. I remember in 2004 or so, it was a big deal when the UAE named its first woman minister. Now, one third of the cabinet are female ministers. And so that part of it, you don't see. And I think that one of the things that all across the Emirates, with varying degrees of success, you saw was this attempt to build up the population, this real investments in education, investments in healthcare that builds up the population that will position them better for the future. We know the story of their infrastructure development, Jerry. Infrastructure development has made the UAE a global trade hub. I mean, think about this for a moment. In 1971, when these seven Emirates got together and they were discussing a union and they finally came to the agreement on the union, could they have imagined that, you know, 50 years later, they would be a global trade hub that actually, with 0.13% of the world's population, does more trade in the world than Brazil or Indonesia? And that's, you know, when you look at the numbers, this is a real global trade hub. It does more international trade than Bahrain, Kuwait, Qatar, and Oman combined times two. So, you know, we're talking about $630 billion worth of trade somewhere between Switzerland and Spain. Then you look at their investment. You know, this is a major global investor. And its sovereign wealth funds are, you know, to you add them all up, you're close to $1 trillion in sovereign wealth funds. It's a major logistics hub, tourism hub, all of these things. I mean, back in 1971, the question was of survival. The question was not of thriving, becoming a major global trade hub, becoming a major geoeconomic actor in the region. So I think, you know, by building up the infrastructure, both the human infrastructure and the connectivity and trade infrastructure, that's been a key component of why the UAE is where it is today.
I think that's really a critical point, a critical issue. But let me follow up on that. And of course, the engine that has driven all of this development has been the exploitation of fossil fuels, the export of oil. And the Emiratis have been fairly, you know, robust in acknowledging that they need to find new ways of developing their economy, that the carbon-based energy model of the past is going to go away, not next year, not in 10 years, but it is going to go away. And they have a growing population, a requirement to diversify, to ensure that they can continue to provide for their young population. How do you see them moving into this new era? And will they be able to make that transition as smoothly as they made the transition, as you said, from these backward, underdeveloped, impoverished Emirates to a very strong international economy today?
That's really the key question, Jerry, right now. And you know the old investor's adage, past history does not ensure future results, right? So it doesn't matter, you know, what you've done for the past 50 years. You know, how are you positioning yourself for the next 50 years? During a recent visit of Dr. Anwar Gargash, the UAE statesman, former Minister of State for Foreign Affairs, he said something very interesting in one of the sessions he held in Washington. He said, "I see the 2020s as the decade of competition in the region." So I think the UAE is keenly aware that there are competitors in the region that are gunning for them. There are competitors that would like to take some of what they're doing, whether it's as a logistics hub or a finance hub or a trade hub or a major global investor, and compete with them and even do it better. And I think Saudi Arabia is the one that everybody is looking at right now. And I don't know how much economic history officials look at, but if you do look at economic history, you will see that, you know, unless you are constantly reinventing and innovating and constantly building for the next 50 years, you will be left behind. I mean, look at Amsterdam of the 17th century. If you looked at Amsterdam of the 17th century, it was the city in the world that everybody looked to, and it looked like it was the center of the world, and it was going to be the center of the world for a long time until London rose and Great Britain had its industrial revolution and Amsterdam played second fiddle to London. China in the 14th and 15th century, when it turned inward, the great China economic story began turning inward as well. So one of the interesting things about this, Jerry, is that the UAE recently announced something called the Projects of the 50. And they've announced this very ambitious, in typical UAE fashion, very ambitious initiative in which they state clearly and fairly boldly that they aim to be the most dynamic economy in the world, right? So we're accustomed to this. We're accustomed to the UAE aiming to be number one and, you know, declaring these bold visions. And sometimes, you know, we are also accustomed to hearing snickering and saying, well, how are they really going to, you know, achieve some of these ambitious goals? But, you know, time and again, when they decided to build the Jebel Ali port, people snickered and they said, well, Dubai just built a port. Why are they going to come to the Jebel Ali port? And now the Jebel Ali port is the ninth busiest container terminal port in the world. Whether it's airports or it's logistics facilities, they keep raising the bar. Now, what do they have to do now? We've seen the model. We've seen the model. There's a Dubai model of the three T's of trade, transport, and tourism. That has worked well. We've seen Abu Dhabi in the broader UAE model where you invest in energy, you invest in education, and then you bring some of those fossil fuel earnings to invest in the global economy for economic diversification, and you invest for future earnings, right? So we've seen that model before. So what do you do next? I think there's a fourth T that the UAE seems to be trying to position itself for. It's the technology T. Can the UAE become a center for artificial intelligence? Nanotechnology, these fourth industrial revolution technologies. Well, they're certainly making a play for it. They're also, you know, quite active in the blockchain space. And I think what we're going to see over the next 10 years or so is the UAE is going to try on several different hats. They do this often and see which one fits best. But clearly, there's a lot of competition out there. And there's, as I said before, past performance does not indicate future results. So they're going to have to keep raising their game.
Courtney, we've heard from Afshin a little bit about the economic side of Emirati development over these past 50 years. And also this idea that the Emirates, like Saudi Arabia, like several of the other oil-producing states in the Gulf and more broadly, are really looking at economic diversification as a key to future economic growth and stability. And you've done some work on that diversification issue. And if you wanted to share with us a little bit what your perspective is, how likely is it that the UAE will be able to successfully transition away from an economy that's so heavily focused on fossil fuels and really remold itself both internally as a more, you know, green economy, but also in terms of its engagement with the world?
That's a great question. And I think it kind of varies from emirate to emirate because, as you mentioned, they are unequal in terms of their economic resources, with Abu Dhabi having the lion's share of hydrocarbon wealth. So Dubai, for instance, is already pretty diversified with the financial services sector, tourism, you know, other industries, the free zones. So it has pretty successfully diversified there already. I would think Abu Dhabi then would be the most difficult because it has the most in terms of hydrocarbon resources. But I do think there is political will. And I think that political will is really important. There's been a lot of really ambitious targets set quite publicly for diversification and also for using clean energy. And you do have the Masdar project in Abu Dhabi, which is working on other alternative sources of energy. So I do think that the Emiratis are serious about this, as are the other Gulf states. I think they've realized, especially with the 2014 crash in oil prices and then with the pandemic and the kind of collapse of the global economy more generally, I think they've realized the fragility of depending on a single resource. And so I do think there is a political will to do this. And also, I think when you look at compared to, for instance, Kuwait, which is a country that I work on quite a bit as well, the Emirates has made good strides in terms of diversifying and also expanding the role of nationals in the private sector, which is a key part of this that I think is not easy to get right. And is also something that is a long range plan, but is something that there is political will and dedication to doing.
All very true. But I wanted to get into a little bit of the foreign policy issues with you, Afshin. And this is an area where, to be entirely frank, the U.S. and the UAE have not always seen eye to eye. I think we've had some differences of opinion about some of the things that they've done in the Horn of Africa, Sudan, Libya, you know. And so while there are many areas where we have worked very closely with the UAE, the Abraham Accords being a clear example. But even in places like Afghanistan and elsewhere, the U.S. and UAE have been very closely connected. But there have been some areas where we see differences. And if you could talk to us a little bit about what you see as UAE's broader regional and global objectives in terms of how it positions itself in the world.
Jerry, one of the interesting things, again, going back to this projects of the 50, is that whether or not this was a clear distinction from the past, say, 5 to 10 years or so, they announced in the principles of this projects of the 50 that they announced, and this was, you know, endorsed at the very highest levels of the UAE government that came forward with this projects of the 50. And they said, and I'm paraphrasing, but from now on, our dominant goal will be economic policy, and our foreign policy will serve that goal. And I don't think that has been the case over the past 10 years or so. Some of the initiatives that the UAE has taken in foreign policy, whether it's in Libya or whether it's in Yemen or elsewhere in the region, these were not initiatives that were done because of UAE economic policy. These were, you know, for reasons of their own, they pursued these initiatives on national security objectives. So are we now to divine, if we're reading the tea leaves, are we now to divine that the UAE is going to pull back from some of that more, say, robust foreign policy in the region, the more interventionist foreign policy in the region towards one that is serving its economic policy. Well, at least that's what they've said. So time will tell whether that is the case.
And this is a good pivot to Courtney. You know, if you wanted to think about the way the Emirates has married these economic interests with its foreign policy interests and a much more ambitious vision for itself in the world, right? How do you see that developing?
Great question. And I know Karen Young has done quite a bit of work on this and on what she calls economic statecraft and the ways in which the Emiratis in particular have kind of used their financial interests and to facilitate foreign policy as well. And I think what we're seeing is, and what we've seen in the past few years is, as I mentioned, a more activist Emirati foreign policy. They're more engaged not just in the Middle East in terms of working with partners in the region, but also in the Horn of Africa. I think one really interesting development that we're seeing just this week, really, is what will happen between Emirati and Iranian relations. I think this is an area in which there could be change as well. And so, especially if prospects of a renewed JCPOA turn sour, and if there is this perceived or real American withdrawal from the region, I can see the Emiratis wanting to become more involved with regional partners. And so I think that's what we're seeing now. I mean, we see it with the announcement of the trilateral agreement. We've seen it with meetings with Iranian security officials as well. And so I do think they're maybe anticipating that the U.S. might be stepping back from the region and that they are going to want to work more with their neighbors, as well as with partners beyond that, because Emirati interests are quite far flung. But I think we'll see a continued very active engagement, particularly in the Middle East.
Yeah, absolutely. And I would also, I think we have time for one more question. And of course, I think here in the United States, there is also intense interest in China and what China is doing. Not as much on China and the Middle East as perhaps, what their activities are elsewhere in the world. And yet, China in the Middle East is a major factor. The Chinese are the number one trading partner for the UAE, as well as several of the other Gulf states today. And how do you see that relationship developing? And what does that mean for the United States going forward?
The Chinese role in the Gulf more broadly, I think, is really fascinating. And we've seen a lot of talk, at least about the Belt and Road Initiative and what that might look like and how Chinese Gulf relations can develop. I mean, I think the Chinese are bigger consumers of Gulf energy than, for instance, the United States. So I think the Chinese piece will continue to become only more important, especially with the Belt and Road Initiative as well. In terms of the specifics between the Emiratis and the Chinese, I'm not as well versed in terms of what's happening specifically, but I do think generally we'll see more engagement, especially economic engagement on behalf of the Chinese, not just in the Emirates, but in Kuwait, perhaps in Qatar and other parts of the Gulf. So I think that they will become more central to Gulf economies, I would say.
You know, Jerry, there's one thing I might want to add, if you don't mind.
No, go right ahead, Afshin.
I think that one of the most interesting cases to follow today, the defining geopolitical issue today, as you know, is the U.S.-China competition around the world, the U.S.-China Cold War. And the UAE is smack dab in the middle of that because the UAE has very robust and dynamic relations with the United States of America, but it also has become a major center of China's exports, a major center of China's investments in the region. The UAE seems almost purpose-built for the Belt and Road Initiative, given its logistics and its infrastructure. And we're already seeing some tensions in the relationship between the UAE and the United States when the question is asked, are you with us or are you with China, right? But I think one layer to add to this would be the following. As we started earlier in this conversation with the UAE as a global trade hub, there's an economic logic to China seeing that and beginning to engage with the UAE as other countries around the world do engage with the UAE in trade and tourism and logistics and that sort of thing. And for the United States, China was still the third largest trade partner of the United States. So we're still crossing the river by feeling for the stone, so to speak, in the U.S.-UAE-China triangle. But I think this one is going to remain front and center in the U.S.-UAE relationship going forward. So, Jerry, I talked about these before and after pictures of the UAE, but if you think about, there's before and after pictures in the world as well. So the UAE is not unique in that respect. We've seen these dramatic transformation of China, dramatic transformation of India, much of sub-Saharan Africa. All of this is being driven by rapid urbanization and unprecedented connectivity and growing middle classes. One of the ways that I think we need to look at the UAE is we need to delocate it simply as a Middle Eastern country. After all, it's a 2-hour flight from Dubai or Abu Dhabi to Mumbai, and it's a 4-hour flight to Beirut, right? The UAE is very much a part of South Asia trade networks. It's very much a part of East African trading networks. And in many ways, whilst it's sometimes called the Singapore of the Middle East, I also refer to it as the Hong Kong of South Asia, and increasingly the Miami of Africa. So I think it's important for all of us who are thinking about the UAE today, to some extent, geolocate it properly and delocate it predominantly from the Middle East and North Africa perspective and put it into this broader Arabian Sea, Indian Ocean network that it is very much a part of, put it into this very much broader world of trade with Iran, Pakistan, India, East Africa, Central Asia, and the Caucasus as well. And once we begin to do that, I think we begin to see the UAE in full as a geoeconomic actor that has punched far above its weight, both domestically and even within its region.
I think that that's a really outstanding point, Afshin, and I think it goes a long way towards explaining why we see the UAE today, in fact, engaging in issues far beyond the region. And I think, you know, in fairness to the confusion and often the unhappiness of other observers, that we see the UAE being a player far afield. And I think that that kind of international and global perspective is exactly the way the Emiratis see themselves and explains a lot. I want to thank Courtney Freer and Afshin Mulvey for joining us today, and back to the studio.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
That was MEI Senior Vice President Jerry Firestein talking to Afshin Mulvey and Courtney Freer. You can follow all of MEI's coverage of the UAE and the other Gulf states on our website at www.mei.edu. Thank you to our listeners for tuning in and to our production team for their work on today's episode. You can follow MEI on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube, and subscribe to our email newsletters for the latest analysis and information about upcoming events. I'm Alistair Taylor. We will see all of you next week.
This has been a presentation of the Middle East Institute. To support MEI's programs and podcasts, please donate at www.mei.edu. Thank you for your support.